Good afternoon, everybody. I'm James Gow. I'm Professor of International Peace and Security, spanning in part the areas of law and war. And I'm delighted that somebody approached me a couple of months ago to say, what would we think about hosting an event to launch the report that we're going to hear about today at King's? And I'm extremely pleased that it all worked out and that some old friends have been able to come together in different formations across this stage. I'm welcoming you on behalf of King's College London and of the School of Law and the Department of War Studies War Crimes Research Group as the hosts of the event, along with the British International Comparative Institute of International Comparative Law, mouthful, which is represented here by Professor Robert McCorkadale, to whom I'm now going to hand over, who will chair the event and introduce our speakers, Justice Michael Kirby and Sonja Biserko, as they introduce and discuss the report of the Commission of Inquiry into Human Rights in Korea. So, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, James. As I say, I'm Robert McCorkadale, Director of the British Institute of International and Comparative Law, and we're delighted to co-host this with King's College London. I'm particularly delighted to be able to introduce the Honourable Michael Kirby, who I first met about 20 years ago at the Australian National University, so it's a bit scary the length of time. I see that my then-dean, Tom Campbell, is here, so it's nice to see you. Michael's achievements are extraordinary, impressive, and I can tell you far, far too many for me to recount them all. So I'm just going to select a few which I think are relevant for what he's talking about tonight. He was Justice of Australia's highest court, the High Court of Australia, for 13 years. He was awarded Australia's highest civilian award, being the Companion of the Order of Australia. He was the first chairman of the Australian Law Reform Commission. He's a member of the Eminent Persons Group of the Commonwealth of Nations, President of the International Commission of Jurists, Special Representative of the United Nations Secretary General for Human Rights in Cambodia, and he had a key role in drafting the Bangalore Guidelines on Judicial Integrity and the UNESCO Universal Declaration on Bioethics and Human Rights. He has had an incredible number of awards, medals, degrees and honours conferred upon him, and both professorships and centres named after him. And these achievements reflect the incredible influence he's had on the law and beyond the law, in Australia and beyond Australia, on governments and beyond governments to people's daily lives. He's always fought to make a difference, and he has done so. Discrimination in its many forms, he's argued against, fought against, and succeeded in many instances. He's phenomenally hardworking and determined, and there's one aspect about him which isn't necessarily in any of his bibliographies and biographies and everything else about him. He's a very keen photographer, so be warned, you might have photos taken afterwards. He's also prepared to stand up against oppression no matter who and in what form, no matter the difficulties and the consequences. And therefore, it was not a surprise that he was asked to be chair of the UN Human Rights Council Commission of Inquiry on Human Rights in the Democratic People's Republic of Korea. Therefore, it's my great honour to introduce to you the Honourable Michael Kirby.
Thank you very much, Robert, and thank you all very much for coming to this session today. Walking down the Strand, my eyes lit upon a book in a bookshop just a little way from here. It's called A Short Book of Bad Judges. And I thought, no, I hope that I have not made it into this short book. But typical of English obsession only with itself, it's all about English judges. A very bad, an extremely bad judge of the 20th century, and so on. So I have that for my delectation and pleasure at 3:30 tomorrow morning when All of you are in your beds, all snug and warm. I am on my way by the shuttle to Heathrow Airport to begin the long, long journey back to Australia. I pay my respects to Sonja, my dear friend and colleague in our enterprise on North Korea. Sonja, it was true, suggested that we should spend 2 days after the official launch of our report with the academic community and with the academies and institutes. And so we did. Yesterday we had an extremely intensive day in The Hague and meeting international judges and international academies. Wonderful day. And today, likewise, in London. This has been very useful and very helpful for our planning for the steps that lie ahead, because the presentation of our report to the Human Rights Council is not the end of our journey. We will conclude our office as commissioners. We will go out of office at the end of this month. But the three of us, the third commissioner is Marzuki Darusman, the former Attorney General of Indonesia, and we two leave office. He remains as a special rapporteur on North Korea, but our journey will continue in a way, because it now seems likely that steps will be taken to bring the matter before interested members of the Security Council, and if that happens, we will be offering our help and briefings and the like to them. But that lies in the future. It's still a little uncertain. The details have yet to be played out, and maybe we'll have time today. Now, I spent most of my time sitting on a podium. Can I say this is a rather dangerous podium? This is a podium full of Donoghue and Stevenson, I think. I feel this is a podium designed to entrap visiting distinguished but aged Australian judges, lest they get carried away with their pretensions of youth and jump down. I'm not sure that I would survive that. So you will hear my voice as I disappear into the interstices of the stairwell and come down, because I'm sick of podiums. I'm sick of being up there all on my own. I'm a person of the people. And so down here I am with all of you, and we're now going to have an engagement. There'll be an introduction about the report. If there's time, and I remember to do so, I have the 10 lessons I have learned from the Commission of Inquiry. And we will now have a democratic vote. It'll be a bit more democratic than the vote in the Crimea, but it'll be a democratic vote. Do you want me to give you a potted version of the report of the Commission of Inquiry, or have you already familiarised yourself with it, or can look it up on the web, so that I give you something that is completely original? That is to say, the lessons learned from engagement in the United Nations Commission of Inquiry process. We will now have a vote. Those who favour a lecture on what the Commission found and the chief issues it addressed and the challenges that lie ahead. Who want that lecture? Raise your hands. There are two, there are a few, yes. Thank you. Those who want a completely original and brilliant lecture on the lessons that have been learned from a year's enterprise of a Commission of Inquiry of the United Nations. Raise your hand.
You mean studying the Crimean referendum?
Okay, well, it looks as though the second wins, but I'll tell you very briefly. The Commission was set up in March 2013, but we were not really appointed until May, and we didn't have our first meeting until the end of June. And so effectively, because we had to get our report out by the end of the year in order that it could be translated into the UN languages, we had about 6 months. So that's what we had. The report was produced in that 6 months. It was brought in on time. It was brought in within budget. It was brought in unanimously. And it was brought in as a readable document. And that, the last, is the greatest achievement of anybody who sets out to rewrite a United Nations report. Because most of them, I'm afraid to say, are not readable, but this one is. And it's readable for a particular reason, that when we were refused access to North Korea, as we expected would happen, we had to devise a strategy for jumping the border, getting in effectively. And the way we did that was by conducting public hearings. I think it probably has to be said that a lifetime of service in institutions, the Law Reform Commission, Federal Court of Australia, the Court of Appeal of New South Wales, the High Court of Australia, had got me into the mood of the English tradition of doing things transparently. Our legal system has many, many faults, the chief of which is connected with its strength. It is extremely expensive and very hard to get to justice. And that grows out of a transparent system of court trial where lawyers represent people if you can afford them. But the strength of it is definitely that judges and inquirers act in public and can be judged all the time themselves by the way they do things and by the record that emanates from their inquiry. And so we had no trouble getting witnesses, none at all. We had a large number of witnesses who gave testimony before us. They mainly came from the community in South Korea who were refugees from North Korea. There are 26,000 such people in South Korea, and there are many others scattered around the world, including here. We had public hearings in Seoul. They were the lengthiest. We had public hearings in Tokyo, in London, and in Washington, D.C. And we had other consultations elsewhere in the world. And we then spent a lot of time together working out how we would respond to the 9-point mandate we received on the chief areas that were thought to trouble the Human Rights Council concerning the shocking crimes against human beings and crimes against humanity, which are revealed in the report. The strength of the report is that on every page or second page is a quote. You can open it at random and you can find this extremely vivid language in with a vividness that could not have been accomplished by us. It's the vivid language of the witnesses. The way they have expressed, generally in the first instance in the Korean or Japanese language, with great vividness what they went through. Holocaust studies show, and it was demonstrated again in this inquiry, that people who have gone through the most awful suffering have an unbearable desire to get it out, to speak of it, to reveal it, and thereby, in a way, to hopefully remove it from them, the worrying them, but also to speak for those who are not here to speak for themselves. And so we had no trouble getting very effective witnesses. The North Koreans have said they are human scum, but their testimony is online. There are transcripts of their testimony online, and anyone in the world who has access to the internet can have access to these people. And I invite you to make your own judgments. I invite you to consider whether, like the Commission of Inquiry, you conclude that these are people of no social great importance. They are not politicians or leaders of their community. Most of them are just ordinary folks, and they have suffered grievously, and they, once they got into the telling of their story, the story became the message. They just felt the obligation to tell it as it was, as they saw it, and sometimes unbearably distressing. And even for a person like myself who spent 34 years as a judge, three times I felt myself unable to continue. It was just so terrible. So that was our technique, that was our product. We then produced our report. I pay a tribute to our secretariat. We had a wonderful secretariat of 10 officers of the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights who, for the interim of our report, were assigned to us. They were independent of the Office of the High Commissioner. They worked directly to the three commissioners. The commissioners weighed every word that the drafts were produced, but every word was weighed. And I think it is a strong, powerful, well-written, succinct, compacted statement of the massive knowledge that comes from lifetime of experience studying North Korea, because there are people who spent their whole lives on the subject, plus these witnesses who spoke of it very directly and personally. It deals with all the issues in the mandate that were given to us, the issues of the prison camps, horrendous suffering and starvation in the prison camps. It deals with the issue of the freedom of movement, or the lack, the total lack of freedom of movement, the restrictions that are put on people. They can't go outside their villages without a license to do so. They certainly can't go overseas, and they're members of the elite. The great famine which struck North Korea in the 1990s, and the million people, on our estimate, who died during that great famine at a time when North Korea was spending huge amounts on MIG fighters and other weapons and material for their delivery system, for their rockets, and to support their nuclear arms engagement. So it was an unnecessary toll in human suffering. They did suffer flooding and climate initiation of the famine, but the first duty of a government is to make sure its people get basic food, and they didn't do that, and the result was about 1 million people perished. Food is not yet fixed up in North Korea. Part of the problem is the command economy. That has been undermined, in a sense, by initiatives mainly taken by women to set up free markets to try and provide food for the people. But food remains a very serious problem, and 28% of young North Koreans, 28% of those who are still being born, are on the figures revealed by the World Health, by the World Food Programme. They suffer from stunting. That means they have not had enough nutrition during gestation for the expansion of their brain and of their bodies, and that is going to inflict lifelong burdens on them and on whoever is in charge of the government of North Korea in years and decades to come. Women suffered grievously. Discrimination against women is rife. There are only 5% of the leadership positions in the legislature who are women, and women were the subject of shocking forced abortions, infanticide of their children, because North Korea has a theory about racial purity, and that theory is practiced when a woman comes from China, is sent back to North Korea, bearing or with a child by a Chinese husband. The Han Chinese are regarded as impure. The Koreans have a notion of the purity and therefore the vulnerability of their race. The Korean political system doesn't deliver in any real way any democracy. We saw recently photographs of a so-called election, but it was an election of the old style, where effectively the role of the people is simply to rubber stamp the candidates chosen by the Korean Workers' Party. The real politics of Korea was demonstrated in the disposal in December last year of Jang Sung-taek, the uncle of the supreme leader, who was seized and in a humiliating way, in a meeting of the Politburo, dragged out from that meeting, put before a military tribunal. The military tribunal contained judges who, according to the news reports, accused them of being shocking enemies of the people and scandalous abusers of the working class. And within 4 days, he was executed, and members of his entourage and family were also reportedly executed as well. That's how the real politics of North Korea is played out at the moment. Abductions were a major issue, particularly in respect of foreign nationals. Japanese nationals were seized, including school children, apparently taken for the purpose of instructing in the latest idiom of the Japanese language, presumably for spying or other like purposes. And the cruelty of the abduction process has outraged Japan, and it's a very serious issue in Japan, but also for the Korean people themselves, because the prisoners of war, who at the end of the Korean War, at the time of the armistice, numbered about 100,000 of them, very small numbers, were returned. And even today, there are people who haven't seen their family members. They ballot for them every year in a family reunion system, but these are crumbs, just crumbs, that are offered to what is a fundamental human right, and that is to know your family, to be embrace your family, to have contact with your loved ones, and not to have to depend on the fiat of a government which forbids telephonic communication, internet communication, postal communication, or any of the other things that we just take fully for granted. So that's the background. We produced our report, we delivered it this week. We've made many recommendations. The recommendations answer the four questions we were asked. We were not at liberty to play politics. That was not our role. Don't please say to me, you should have been more discreet. You should have just been a little softer on North Korea. You should have withdrawn from being so cruel and nasty as to tell the Supreme Leader that he might himself be liable under international law. That is painting him into a corner. You should have been more politic in the way you dealt with the matter. Well, that was just not our function. That may be other people's functions. It may be functions that lie ahead. Wasn't our function. Our functions were very simple, and they were subordinate. They were to answer four questions. Are there abuses of human rights demonstrated in the case of North Korea? Answer to that, yes, plenty. And evidence to back it up. Evidence as follows. Do any of the abuses of human rights rise to the level of crimes against humanity, an international crime? Yes, and we listed the crimes that were so demonstrated, meeting the criteria for crimes against humanity. Acts of violence against civilian populations targeted as an act of state on the part of a nation state, and on the basis of such acts of violence, we were able to find crimes against humanity. We held back, and this might be a subject of questions, from making a finding of genocide, but there are plenty of crimes against humanity. Third question, in the event that the answer to that is yes, is anybody accountable in international law? The answer to that is yes, people are accountable for the acts of violence, and we identify them, if not by name, then by office and time and where they were, and that is all set out in the report. And fourthly, how can we render such accountability a reality? We went through the possibilities, truth and reconciliation, no Nelson Mandela in North Korea, a joint tribunal such as the one in Cambodia. The courts of North Korea could not be trusted with that responsibility. An ad hoc tribunal, the Yugoslavia tribunal or the Rwanda tribunal, the international community is a bit out of love with such tribunals now because they are expensive and they are slow, and therefore that doesn't seem to be a starter. They also would require probably the resolution of a Security Council motion. And finally, we came to the International Criminal Court, which is established, which has a prosecutor, which has officers, which has funding, and which would look better if it had jurisdiction that was exercised somewhere out of Africa, because most of their cases have concerned Africa. It cannot assume jurisdiction unless a state is a state party to the Rome Statute. But North Korea is not a party to the Rome Statute. However, there is one alternative way in which the ICC can get jurisdiction if jurisdiction is referred to it by the Security Council of the United Nations. And that was what we proposed, that there should be jurisdiction referred to it. Now, media, who always want immediate answers to every question, they want it like now, are impatient of that suggestion. They say that one of the permanent five countries on the Security Council, if not a couple of them, are likely to veto this resolution. Well, they may. That might happen. Indeed, that might happen. During the debate in the Council of Human Rights this week, 37 countries specifically, expressly, and by name adopted what the Commission of Inquiry had suggested and said that there should be a referral to the Security Council. China raised a number of objections to the report, and what they said was not very comforting to a referral, but let us just wait and see. China is a very great country, a great power, a great civilization, an extremely important economy, and China's economic advance has undoubtedly improved human rights in China. There's no doubt about that at all. And China is sensitive to issues of human rights. So how this will play out is not entirely clear, but it will play out. And we should, as citizens of the world and as people concerned about the future effectiveness of international law, we shall all be watching. And those of us who can will be playing a part which is supportive but subordinate. Now, I now come to the 10 lessons. And unfortunately, because I've spoken for so long and only have a shamefully short time for this lecture, I have to be very brief. I'll just give it to you in skeletal form. The first lesson I learned was a lesson I sort of instinctively knew because of the experiences I've had in my life, unusual experiences for a domestic judge, of engagement with the international community. It was of the growing importance of international law and the growing importance of the institutions of international law and the specific growing importance of the international institutions of universal law, of international law of human rights. And this is one exercise in that field. And it is, I think, an exercise, not yet concluded, which even if nothing else happens, is a success. Because we have borne witness for those who have not had a voice. And we have spoken up in due course of time when the people of Korea hear about what happened with the Commission of Inquiry of 2013-14. They will know that the world was sufficiently concerned to set up this body and to go through the processes of considering its report. A number of the ambassadors in Geneva this week who come from countries which were countries of the former Soviet bloc said to us how important our work was, looking at it from the point of view of those who had been down this journey at an earlier stage of history. The second lesson was the value of transparency. It has a value all in its own, all of its own, because transparency is the modern way of governance. The notion that nanny knows best and that you can leave it to experts including, let it be said, experts in international law, is really not a full answer. You have to engage with people. You have to give people a voice, and we certainly did that. We called for submissions, we had public hearings, we put the testimony online. It is a truthful answer to the assertion that the testimony is that of human scum. We reported online, and we gave our report to the Human Rights Council online. All of this is on the website, and anybody in the world, except in North Korea, can have access to it. North Korea does not give access to its people to the internet. They have access to an intranet, which is a step forward, but not to the internet. The third value was the value of respecting the victims. In my earlier life, working in HIV/AIDS, I was greatly affected by a lesson that was taught to me by a really great international civil servant, Jonathan Mann. Jonathan Mann was the first director of the Global Program on AIDS, and he kept insisting, do not speak down to people living with HIV. They must speak to us. They must always be engaged. They must always have a voice. They must always be part of the solution. And that's the attitude which we brought to bear in dealing with the witnesses and the victims in North Korea. The fourth lesson was the value of scholars in international law. And this is what we're engaged in today, talking about international law, engaging with scholars and experts. Some of them gave evidence before our inquiry, and their testimony is available online. There are some interesting and intriguing puzzles of international law which we dealt with. I mentioned the genocide question. This is, in a nutshell, the genocide puzzle. The genocide puzzle is that genocide, the international crime of genocide, as it is defined in terms of conduct targeting a population on the basis of race, nationality, ethnicity, and religion. And in the case of North Korea, there is not, with one exception, evidence of that kind of genocide. But their discrimination and their deadly action against population groups is based on politics, on actual or perceived political opinion. There is a hot debate in some international law circles as to whether politics is something different and that you shouldn't contaminate genocide by extending its ambit. But if you think of it, religion is not something like race, ethnicity, nationality, which tends to be either inborn or law affixes it by reference to birth. Politics is generally something which you get a bit later in life, like religion. And therefore, in terms of a concept, the concept of a worldview, an attitude to the world and an attitude to your place in society and your relationship with society and with God is similar to politics. And certainly the politics of North Korea, where the Kim family are elevated to a semi-theistic position. So international scholars have helped and can help in the consideration and examination and criticism of the report. The fifth lesson was the importance of media. Now, media is a turbulent, dangerous beast, but media are essential to speak up and to bring matters to the attention of a wide audience. And that certainly has been done in the case of DPRK. Part of our transparency approach was one of engaging with media. And I think people in the future who take a part in international commissions of inquiry for the United Nations need to get a bit of media training. I've been asked by the office to prepare a note. I've jotted down a similar one-pager concerning what we did and how we did it and how we got a good attention of the international media, which has been, on the whole, with a few celebrity-type exceptions, has been positive and useful. So that will, in due course, be available, and I might even turn it into a law review article. The sixth lesson is the value of civil society. The Commission would not have got off the ground but for Human Rights Watch. They were the ones who kept hammering away. North Korea has been brilliant in sailing under the radar, in keeping off the attention of the international community, but Human Rights Watch, Amnesty International, International Commission of Jurists and others have continued to hammer away at the nation states and to suggest and expect and demand the setting up of the commission. The seventh, the interconnection of human rights and geopolitics. That interconnection is really recognised in the Charter, in the preambular statements of the United Nations, speaking about its purpose, reference is made to the threefold objectives of the United Nations, which include international peace and security and universal human rights. The eighth lesson is the interconnection between human rights and domestic politics. The connection is evident in Japan with the very strong political engagement with the abduction issue. It's evident in relation to China, where China is obviously very concerned about refugees pouring into China from North Korea. It's evident in the Republic of Korea, South Korea, in the way in which South Korea deals with the 26,000 people who've come from North Korea and those who have connections with any connections at all with North Korea, and so on. The ninth lesson is the value and importance of follow-up, and that's the lesson we're learning now, the engagement with the follow-up to the report and the possible engagement with a procedure in the Security Council and with other nation states and with civil society to make sure that the Commission report is not just buried. The ninth, the tenth lesson is the value and importance of having a really good secretariat. We had a fantastic secretariat. First of all, we had a very good team of the commissioners. I love professors. I myself am a 12-fold professor in Australia and in Hong Kong. I think you do need a good mix in a commission of inquiry. You need a mix of people who've had practical experience. Marzuki Darisman, as an attorney general, had a lot of experience in prosecution and in the issue of following up serious crimes. My experience had been judicial, and Sonja Biserko's experience has been in the field of civil society and academia, and the mix was very good, and the mix of our talented secretariat was marvellous. One of the matters that our secretariat constantly brought home, like the knocking on the gate in the play Macbeth, was gender. Gender. Don't forget the issue of gender. Even language. Now, I thought I knew all the rules of gender language, but I had to learn another one. For those who do not know, the word fisherman is out. In the English language, fisherman may not be used. The word that can be used is fisher, which is a very ancient English word. When I was a boy at Sunday school, I learned the hymn, I will make you fishers of men. Anybody else ever learn that hymn? I will make you fishers of men, fishers of men, fishers of men. I will make you fishers of men if you follow me. Big round of applause for that. All right, that's enough. That's enough. Well, fishers are in, fishermen are out. The only compromise I was able to extract was that the first time the idea was referred to, fishermen would appear, with a brackets, inverted comma, Fisher. And therefore, thereafter, it became Fisher. We laugh at these things, but non-sexist language reinforces non-sexist attitudes. And one of the curiosities of our report is that it hasn't attracted much attention to the issue of women and the issue of Christian discrimination against Christians. Somehow that doesn't seem to grab the international media, and I hope that we can work on that in the future. Okay, I've given you the 10 lessons. I've told you the background of the report. We've now got about a quarter of an hour in which we can have some further engagement, but you can't say you haven't had value for money. You've got two lectures for the price of one, all in a very short time, and I think it deserves, as they say in Korean publications from North Korea and in the old publications from the old Soviet Union, thunderous, prolonged applause. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Michael. Would you like Sonja to say something?
Oh,
this is Sonja Biserko, who was one of the commissioners with Michael.
It's always difficult to speak after Michael because he's such a great speaker. Anyway, I would maybe make a few points just to add to what we have, to our findings. And I would say that famine was one of the critical points when society itself in a way became on its own because the state didn't have means to provide a minimum of food to every citizen. And since then, I would say the society in North Korea somehow started its own struggle for survival without this minimum provisions of the food. And in a way, it really opened the avenue to some changes, which were also blessed by the government in terms that they relaxed situation, first of all, in crossing the border to China and allowing people, first of all, women, to get engaged in trading and growing some products for their own use. And so since then, I would say women, as Michael has said, in all these previous situations were really harshly repressed, and it was one of the horrific aspects of the testimonies that we have heard. But somehow this new situation enabled them or empowered them in a way, because they became the main pillar of survival of the family. And it is up till today. And many articles that we have read along the time indicate that certain regions close to China have become, let's say, more prosperous, so that you have a kind of new elite coming from below, those who have been engaged in smuggling and producing and so on. So this is one small aspect of the new reality in North Korea. And of course, the government have never been able, in the meantime, to obtain such harsh control as before, because the hunger or the food supplies, as Michael has indicated, is always the continued problem for North Korea. Of course, this decade of this really horrible famine, which is one way of imposing very harsh conditions for the entire nation, and this is where possibly genocidal intentions could be defined, which our commission hasn't been dealing with, but there was some pressure from outside to deal with this as well, but this is now left to those who will use the report in the later phases. However, I think that this, in a way, has opened some potentials for the society, and as we can see, that change of the government, of the leadership in North Korea, is in a way also a problem, because the young leader who was expected to be more flexible, being in Switzerland for some years, many people hoped that he would bring some changes into his into this country. But however, this very change or consolidation of his power was followed by really very repressive and very brutal moves, like execution of his uncle and many his close associates, about 3,000, I think. Some of them were executed and many of them dislocated to the northern provinces. This is a reality from which one can derive certain conclusions hope that these little changes within the country will help some kind of rebel. And we have been talking about that in many occasions, especially these days when Michael was delivering his speeches, asking the question why people, the refugees in the South Korea, about 26,000 of them, were not able to rebel or organize themselves for something to undertake in the North Korea. But coming from the region which I come from, which is the Balkans, and being there during all the years of this, disturbing years, in almost for two decades now, I can say that refugees are really the most difficult segment of population to deal with. First of all, they're also traumatized and unable to deal with what was left behind them. Their urge is really aimed at survival, the survival of them and their family. And it takes time before they get organized. But there is also one other aspect of for reflection, and this is that many information come from those refugees who spent some years or time in China, who come back with DVDs and all kinds of goods which are not known in North Korea. And this, in a way, changes also the attitudes. I don't know to what extent, but however, this is also one very important aspect of changing the mindset, maybe not to greater extent, but however, to the extent that people want to improve their lives, first of all, in consuming all kinds of goods which are available from China. And when we were talking to some experts who know North Korea well, including Victor Cha, for example, because in his book he mentions Arab Spring and possible impact on North Korean society, because it became somehow vogue in many of the Middle Eastern countries. When we asked him question whether it would be possible to expect similar scenarios in North Korea, his answer was that everything is there, but it's very difficult to say whether and when changes will take place. So when we are talking about North Korea today, with this report that has come as a result of the inquiries that we have made over the last few months, it is obviously that something must happen or something must be undertaken. And I think this report has created some kind of momentum in terms that something has, that North Korea is shamefully isolated for so long, and it's shame that international community was not able to take its North Korea situation high on the priority, instead dealing with the nuclear program, who never knows how strong it is and how relevant it is. And I hope that this report and everything surrounding it over the last 2 months and maybe in the months to come will help really elevate interest for the North Korean people and, as first of all, force international community to deal with the reality in North Korea, with this enormous human rights violations which go on for decades. And I think I really, once I got involved in this, I was really ashamed when listening to these people's stories that it went on for so long unnoticed and nobody cared. And as Michael said, now we know, and I hope things will be changing over the next month, whether it will come from inside or outside, but I really hope that the lives of the North Koreans will very soon change. And I will stop here because I think you have to ask some questions to Michael and maybe I can...
Thank you, Sonja. Well, you've heard the wisdom of the greats. Are there questions? I'll gather a group of questions and then put them to the... If you could identify who you are. Do you have a microphone? Great.
Hi,
You identify who you are, and that would help a lot. Yes, if you could go up a couple of rows. Thanks, Jim.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Sophie. I'm doing a master's at King's here. My question is about a campaign I understand is underway at the BBC.
It has to be handled right in front so that we hear it.
Can you hear me better now? My question is about a campaign I've understood is underway at the BBC to set up broadcasting into North Korea in the Korean language, in the same way that the BBC did under in the Soviet times and under occupied Europe under the Nazis. And I wondered what you thought a similar BBC World Service, what kind of impact that would have on the North Korean people in terms of empowering them about what's happening in the wider world, and also just in terms of giving them that kind of psychological support that, you know, the world is sort of thinking about them. Thank you.
There's a question in the far top up there, second from the row. Sorry, Jim.
My name is Nicholas Vulgaris. I'm doing a PhD here. Two very short questions on prosecution. Do you think that these people you found are responsible, who I presume they hold official positions, if they can be found responsible before national courts? And the second question is that if the ICC issues an arrest warrant against these people, can this have an effect? I mean, can it grab them from there, or if they travel abroad, do you think it's going to be easy to actually put them before the International Criminal Court? Thank you very much.
Thank you. Any other questions? Can you cut down just a few things?
Hello, I'm Julia Marlowe. I'm a lawyer at Hogan Lovells. I was just wondering about the genocide issue and about the presentation of it as being against political groups. I wonder whether actually there was any argument that you could recast it in some way, because it's obviously also very strongly based on the social structure that's been created. And I wonder whether there was any other way of looking at it that would allow us to apply the genocide word that has so much impact.
Okay, I've just got one more question for this row. Did you have the same question? Yes. Could you just pass it down the row, please, Jimmy?
Well, I was also going
Sorry,
to
can
ask,
you say who you are, please?
Michael Rank. I'm a freelance journalist. I was also going to ask about genocide, but could I also ask, has the report been translated into Korean, where it could potentially get infiltrated into North Korea?
It's been translated into Korean. Oh, yes. Okay, well, Michael or Sonja, why don't you answer those few questions? You'll keep going.
Sure.
Question number one was BBC into North Korea. I'm an old-timer, and I know when I see a national political controversy to be avoided. I myself expressed a personal opinion on this subject as somebody who throughout life has been listening to and watching the BBC. I've got the greatest of respect. I believe it is still the premium news service in the world. And I believe, despite occasional blips, it is trusted and it is not yet debased by celebrity and superficiality. And therefore, self-evidently, the BBC could play a useful role in North Korea. I understand something, a little, about the funding issues in this country and the change in funding arrangements and how the controversy now arises. And I don't want to get into a political controversy with the United Kingdom, which is a P5 country and will therefore be playing a very important role in the months to come. But if you focus on what is in the interests of liberty and justice and universal human rights in North Korea, the more and more reliable information that can be secured by the people of North Korea, the better. Getting that information in across the jammers and the barriers and all the other impedimenta is the biggest challenge. And we have to confront that and deal with it. But apart from that, I think it's really something for the people of the United Kingdom through their elected representatives to sort out how engaged they feel with the Korean issue. It may be that our report, which shines light into a land of darkness, will itself affect attitudes to what the United Kingdom should do with one of its premium sources of information about freedom. Now, as to prosecution, could the prosecution be done by national prosecutors in due course? Maybe, but one of the most important things we did was to collect testimony, and we've put that in a database. The High Commissioner for Human Rights becomes the residual repository of the database, and one of our suggestions, which has been commended by the draft resolution before the Human Rights Council, is that the database should continue to be enlarged by a regionally based organisation which can continue to collect the information and add to it as more and more information becomes available on ongoing breaches of fundamental human rights. Would the ICC reference, if it happens, have an effect on the culture? I think even as a number of ambassadors have told us, especially from Eastern European countries, just the report has a potential to influence for the good the awareness of people in North Korea, if they get to know about it, concerning their own vulnerability to the high crimes laid down by international law in the case of crimes against humanity and aiding, abetting and personal command responsibility for such serious crimes. So we have started a process, and that process will continue until there is, as the Human Rights Commission Council demanded, accountability of those who are responsible. On the question of genocide, it is a very interesting issue. I find it an interesting issue because it is a conflict between, on the one hand, a good workable category, which is expressed in international treaties, but the issue is whether international customary law has moved on to a wider concept. I spent most of my time as a judge because of the 10 years I spent as chair of the Australian Law Reform Commission, having a battle with those who wanted to deal with legal issues at the highest level as categories, and those who wanted to see what the categories illustrated as a concept. You know the joke about the common law, which is that it builds on categories one by one, and if in a couple of centuries it stumbles over a principle, well, it's a wonderful accident and it's most rich and up and rewarding. But, you know, I'm impatient for the principles and the concepts. So what we did actually was we said, look, this is the controversy, these are the views. The majority of scholars seem to say, stick to what we've got, don't expand and thereby debase this notion of genocide. But we said the commissioners are themselves tend to favour an expansion to a wider category. And it may be, as you suggested, that the Songbun system, that is to say the categorisation of the people by social class in the peculiarities of North Korea, would provide a way whereby you wouldn't embrace the whole of politics, but you would at least say, at least in the case of the politics ascribed to people like a caste by reference to their purported political views, would be such a case. Now, as to translation, I agree absolutely with your question. And in fact, I made particular representations to the Korean missions in Australia and elsewhere to try to persuade them to make available even the informal translations, which by now would exist, of the summary report. The report is in two parts. There is a summary report of about 20 pages, and then there's the full report with all the findings, which are about 370 pages. The summary report, I gather, is going to be uploaded within the next few days. So that will be a definite step forward. And we have made representations both to Japan and Korea to make the summary reports available at once and the full report available without undue delay. So they are the answers to the four questions. I don't know if Sonja wants to elaborate.
Okay, let's take a few more questions. One down the front, please. One row back.
Hi, my name is Krista Kamga. I'm a youth director of Youth UPF and a graduate student of Korean Studies at SOAS University. I understand that most of the movements that actually did make a change came from inside, and we are very far. I mean, with North Korea, it's really far for this to happen. There's a lot of surveillance happening. You have to say, you know, what your neighbor is doing. And I mean, is there not a way? I do know as well that it's not possible. It's not exactly possible for the ICL to, you know, uproot a president from there. But it's, how can we put more pressure? Maybe because of all the stories we've got, is it not possible to actually, you know, stop it somehow? Yeah, that's my question.
I'm Jim Tahir Kelly. I'm a founder of an international charity called Basic Human Rights. And before I came here, of course, you hear what you do on the news about North Korea. And I've briefly been reading your report on The Guardian while you were talking. But I would say that the report is obviously to highlight the violations against the people of North Korea. And the primary purpose has to be to end that violence against the people of North Korea. In order to make that sustainable and really happen from the grassroots, surely isn't that by having a dialogue with the regime? And how are you going to bring that about?
Dan, Jane, you want one?
I'd like to take you back to genocide and ask if you gave any consideration to the issue of infanticide, as you described it, in relation to the crime of genocide, where it seems the intent is to kill, destroy it because of who, what they are. And I've got a couple of other quick questions, if I may, just to throw on the end. Have you kept good records? Have you got all the documents, logged all the footnotes, unlike the Bassiouni Commission on the war crimes in Yugoslavia, which created many issues years after when it came to prosecution? And a question specifically for Sonja, given the wide experience of dealing with human rights questions in different contexts. Is the DPRK in a different category to all those other questions?
I'll take one more. There is one, yes, just a few rows back.
Hi, I'm Stephen at the International Development Institute at King's College London. The report is mainly based on witnesses' accounts, refugees' accounts. When you interview these refugees, have you considered the biases that they would have? I mean, they're interviewed or they undergo certain programs of the South Korean Secret Service after they come. They might have geographical biases. They might have ideological biases, and obviously fleeing the country, they obviously have a bias against the regime. So how does the report take account of that?
Okay, thank you, Michael.
On the first question of how somehow we could respond quickly to this problem, North Korea is a nation state. It is a nation state which has been admitted to membership of the United Nations. We are a body set up by the Human Rights Council of the United Nations. We must accept the member states of the United Nations. We have no entitlement, for it would be a presumption to say that we take over what belongs to the people of North Korea, that they should change their regime. That is not our prerogative, it was not in our mandate, and what we had to do was approach the matter addressing North Korea, South Korea, China, other countries that are affected in a respectful way and saying what each of them has to do and what the international community and its agencies have to do within the current structure. I understand your impatience, but our recommendations are addressed to how within the structure changes can be secured as quickly as possible. I would call to your attention that towards the end of the report is a whole range of person-to-person contacts, which, if there were a will, could set in train steps to, as in Ireland, where there is a border. My people came from Ulster, Protestant Irish, and therefore, in some ways, I understand a land divided by a border. But what you learn when you go to Ireland, which comes as a bit of a shock for an Australian out there in the colonies who hasn't had a contact with Ireland in recent times, is how keenly the Irish people on both sides of the border feel their Irishness and how they feel a deep association with each other. And that is the beginning of a wisdom that leads to improvement in action. How we can trigger that. Don't forget, in the Irish case, it was helped by a little international engagement. But it was also helped by an insistence on accountability. You remember both in the trials in Britain and in Ireland, it was insistence of no impunity. People should not be allowed to do things and live side by side without resolution of the deep pain that people on both sides of the border have caused to each other. I think, therefore, there are ways that things can be done, but it does require a trigger to change things. And I hope that in history we'll say that this was something that contributed to the trigger. Secondly, so far as dialogue with the regime, I agree, dialogue is essential. No one could have tried harder than the commissioners to have dialogue. We wrote, I think, 10 letters of engagement. We suggested that we come to Pyongyang to converse. We even when we sent the report, we said we are willing to come there and talk to them, answer officials, engage with them and discuss things. All such approaches are totally rebuffed. That is their technique, I'm afraid. They will not engage. And what is needed is something in effect to oblige them or encourage them or help them to engage. And I hope that will arise out of the report. On genocide, I'll leave the answer to that to Sonja, but I don't think we should get too diverted. We had oodles of crimes against humanity. And as Professor Bill Chavez points out, it is already a gold standard crime. It is not a second-rate international crime. It is not to be treated as if it were a lesser being, and genocide is the big gold standard, and unless you get genocide, well, it's not such a bad old regime after all. And we refer to some of these comments in our report, I think we adopted, if you like, a rather common law, practical thing. We don't need to resolve that. There is a scholarly question. It can be debated by scholars. Meantime, we've got oodles of crimes against humanity, and we should get on with making people accountable for that. And finally, the question about the people from North Korea in South Korea. I've said in recent days that it is a big puzzle to me why the people, 26,000, have not had some sort of organisation, a civil society organisation of their own. I know that the constitution of South Korea makes claim to be the government of the whole peninsula. I know that the government of North Korea makes claim to be the whole government and that their constitutions reflect this assertion. But that's within the paradigm of the position of the governments. What I'm asking is, why didn't a number of the 26,000 form some sort of body, not a government in exile. That has been used, and I don't think that's the right expression, but a group that, drawing on their experience and knowledge of what needs to happen, could become a really important sounding board and information source for the international community, so that, in Jonathan Mann's words, they can speak to us instead of so-called experts and professors and international people speaking to them and about them. I think that this is something that should happen, and I think the questioner had the germ of the answer, why not? South Korea has very stern security laws. Making contact with North Koreans is a security offence. A member of the legislature of South Korea was last month sentenced to 10 years imprisonment for having made contact with North Koreans. And therefore, there's a need on both sides of the border to improve the their view about dialogue and the needs of law reform. And the leadership has to come in this respect, I think, from South Korea, because it's a modern, vibrant, dynamic economy. You know, if you look at the economies of this world over the last 20 years and you see who are the top economies on GDP per capita, gradually South Korea is getting up there with the tops. It's already in the top 10, but it's on the way to overtaking Britain, even Germany. It's an amazing story. And therefore, you stop and think, it's a little bit like the Holy Lands. If only these people could get their act together and live in peace and harmony and love with one another, there would be there'd be almost nothing they couldn't achieve. And I think that is going to require leadership and sacrifices from positions that have been adopted. All of these things can be explained by the war. All of these things can be explained by understanding the devastating carpet bombing of both sides of the Korean border in the war. And all of this is explained in what I think is probably the most unputdownable chapter of our report, which is written by someone who is in this room, Christine Chung. Mm-hmm. She doesn't like me singling her out because they have this sort of anonymity principle in the United Nations, but it is a marvellous chapter, and it explains, it all goes back to the fact that this is a peninsula and these are a people who have suffered a kind of international nervous breakdown, and they need help, but above all, North Korea needs help, and the international community has to really put all intelligence to work on how we can get that help. But it has to be help on a foundation of justice and no impunity for grave crimes against humanity.
Thank you.
Well, of course, North Korea is really an extreme case, probably close to what Cambodia was. But there is always comparison, at least for me, who comes from that region, in terms of understanding the mechanisms which lead to human rights violations. First of all, it's one-party system with heavy control of army, intelligence services, judiciary, and especially media. So media is instrumental in creating this fear, which was both characteristic in Serbia, for example, going back to the victimhood feelings of the Serb nation and mobilizing them on that and preparing them for the war. Well, I mean, Yugoslavia was a complex state, but I'm now talking how Serbs were conditioned for that war. Similarly, in North Korea, one has to have, as described in this chapter that Michael has mentioned, the historical context of North Korean, North Korea, but also Korean Peninsula as whole. First of all, colonial rule of Japanese, then this bloody Korean War, liberation after the with Kim Il-sung as a leader, and so on. But then, in order to keep this entire society in some kind of subordination, this is also, I would say, a reflection of the character of these societies, he instrumentalized, first of all, this fear against the hostile forces, as we call them, Japan, South Korea, and the United States in the case of the North Korea. And, of course, this heavy control by intelligence, Boibu and army, which is 1,200,000 as a whole. And then, of course, media, which was really brainwashing and still brainwashing the entire nation. And I think this will be the biggest problem once things change, in bringing the entire nation to some condition to understand what is the outside world, because there is a total disconnection with the outside world and the lack of understanding certain values, like, let's say, human rights concept, what it is. And I think there needs to be some kind of reconceptualization of education in North Korea in order to humanize people, because this fear and constant threat of physical extermination totally dehumanizes society. And this is, I think, when we talk about what should be done after the changes, is one of the biggest challenges for the government, for the international community and civil society. And one thing, when we talk about Yugoslavia and Serbia, international factor was present from the very beginning. It was apparently one factor in the crisis. Whereas in North Korea, international community is always dealing with North Korea, but totally on different agenda. So regime is always below the radar and can do and gets away with everything internally. I mean, in terms of human rights violations, because the nuclear program is always has a priority. I think this report maybe may help to bring back human rights on the agenda in a proper way, and really to give it the right, meaning and right attention. But generally speaking, what I have seen there and sensed is really unique. I mean, all comparisons are there, mechanisms and everything, but that it lasts for so long, and that there hasn't been, or we don't know of, any rebels, that the regime was able to, to sort of subordinate an entire nation to such an extent, to bring them to a kind of inhuman condition, not being able to reflect on the situation. Many witnesses that we talked to were able to transfer their story, but very few were able to describe the regime and the conditions. And this is really what is troublesome in terms of what the world will have to deal with after the things change. And it very much depends how the change will take place, who will be the initiator of that, and who will stay. So because the character of changes also is determining what and how the society will deal with the past, at least for the time being. So we already have this in our case. So it's.
Thank you, Sonja.
Could I just supplement all the answers on genocide to say that one of the most telling statistics is the fact that at partition, the Christian population of North Korea was 23% in a population now of 23 million. The present number of Christians in North Korea, according to the figures released by DPRK itself, is 0.016%. And therefore, the Christian population has been totally decimated in North Korea, and it's been decimated by the kind of information that is set out in our report of great cruelty and violence of anybody who has any connection with anything that is other than Kim Il-sungism and Kim Jong-ilism. And the witnesses explain why that is so. Now, even if you adopt the orthodox and limited view about what genocide is, it may be that that is a case of the genocide of a group in the community, of the civilian community, on the basis of their religion. But we didn't stay to resolve that because of the fact that we had so much else to do with, deal with, and we had answered the questions given to us by the Human Rights Council. Always keep in mind, we did not have the privilege to mess around in politics. Our job was fact-finding. It was subordinate, but it was enough, and we answered it. Now, I'm going to now ask a question of the audience, because I saw some facial expressions when I referred to the fact that a member of the legislature of the Republic of Korea, South Korea, was recently tried, found guilty, and sentenced to 10 years imprisonment for crimes against the security laws of South Korea by reason of the fact that he was alleged to have had association with a group that had had association with North Koreans, and that that was enough to make him guilty of the security offence in South Korea. I'd be interested to know, this is not compulsory voting because we're not in Australia, you don't have to vote, but if you're willing to indicate, hands up those who knew of that case. Hands up those who did not know of that case. Yes, that answers my question. And it answers the question in a way that reflects the concern of the Commission of Inquiry. And when I go to the Republic of Korea, I may even tell them about what you indicated was your knowledge of this case. It's a case, when we're talking about human rights, it's universal. It is universal. That's what Eleanor Roosevelt, John Humphrey, René Cassin demanded. It is universal. It belongs to everyone, and it must be observed by everyone. And that includes both sides of the Korean Peninsula.
Well, thank you. You've heard an extraordinary array of thoughts, which have been erudite, they've been informative, they've been contextual, and above all, engaging. And I think that's also reflective of the report itself, and I would encourage you to read it. At least read the 21-page summary, that's a worthwhile start. But the 375 pages is just incredibly illuminating and a very good, it's a good practice example of how a fact-finding commission can work and find out the information in a way which then, we hope, others will take forward to uncover and unearth what is obviously a situation which has been for far too long hidden from the international community and for which they need to take action. So on that note, thank you first of all to James and Philippa and King's College London for this, and Gemma for running around with the microphone too. Thank you for your engagement with this, and above all, thank you to Sonja and to Michael for their fantastic engagement tonight.